Good evening, and thank you all so much for coming tonight and helping us keep the arts alive in Summit. I'm Ann Pointer, Director of Theater and Forensics here at Summit High School, and this could truly be one of the most special moments in my career, because in the midst of a global pandemic, when so many theaters are closed and artists are out of work, we're doing live theater. None of this would be possible if we did not have the enthusiastic support of our administrators, our Board of Education, and our community. Most of my colleagues are having to do their shows virtual or not at all. But in September, Mrs. Grimaldi, Mrs. Aaron, and Mr. Murtaugh met with the performing arts teachers at Summit High School to help us brainstorm safe ways for our students to perform. And thus, the Performing Arts Garden, where young artists go to grow. Isn't this amazing? Our brilliant design team, David Robertson, who did our set design, Leo Hidalgo, our lighting designer, Stephanie Gallegos, our technical director, Catherine Winter, our costume designer, created this beautiful space so we can tell this very important story. We are so appreciative of Spark, who has been supporting the performing arts in all seven Summit schools since 1996. To the Hilltopper Stage Productions, who help us manage the finances of all of our shows. To our many parent volunteers, we could not run a program like this without you. We are so blessed to have you. And of course, to our student crews and actors who have been working tirelessly and passionately for the past 5 weeks, 3 weeks less than we normally spend to mount a fall production to make this miracle happen. We want to assure you that we have followed the health protocols established by the National Federation of High Schools. Like all the sports teams, every one of our students submits a COVID health questionnaire 24 hours before every practice or performance. We take their temperatures as soon as they arrive. Masks are worn at all times except when the actors are outdoors on stage and they are distanced. You will note there's no hand-holding or kissing in our show tonight. They remove their mask right before they come on stage. We have an over-the-door shoe organizer with their name on a pocket. They put their mask into their individual pocket, and as soon as they exit, they put their mask right back on. Masks are required of everybody in the audience. Now that you're seated, you may remove your mask, but at intermission, when you get up to go get that really fun snack, to look at the beautiful display board of the Real Radium Girls, or to go to the restroom, you must wear your mask. The restrooms are on the side of the stage, go through this door into the math wing. You'll take a left, and those are the only restrooms open to the audience. Please don't get up and move during the show. The acts are less than an hour each, and there's actors who are making their entrances and exits on that side, so that would be kind of a problem. We do wish that you would turn off your cell phones when actors are up here. It's very distracting for them to see the lights from the cell phones out of the audience. But the good news is, unlike most of our shows, you can eat and drink during the performance. Enjoy. We want to dedicate our show tonight to our fellow artists in hopes that soon we can all return to our home theaters. And now, the Summit High School Theater Arts presents the true story of a few young working girls from Orange, New Jersey, who raised their voices to fight for justice and for better working conditions for all of us. It's my pleasure to present Radium Girls.
Almost felt like you were sitting outside. It was that bright.
That surprised you, Grace?
It was a factory. I thought it would be dark and dirty.
Then why go to work there?
I was 15. It was time I paid my own way.
Pay your own way? What about school?
Oh, I didn't miss it so much. The girls were all so nice, and the work wasn't hard. It wasn't like factory work, really. It was more like art painting those dials. We were artists.
I'm not the one you should be talking to. Von Sashaki, he's the one you should talk to.
Now, Arthur, you know he won't talk to us.
It was his process.
Tell me more about this process, Arthur. You used a powder?
We used a powder. The girls mixed it with an adhesive to make the paint. And that business with the brushes, I didn't invent that. They were doing that when I started there.
But you knew about it.
We all knew about it. We just didn't realize what it meant.
Irene!
Over here.
Irene, what are you doing?
Shut the door.
Amalia's working inspection today.
Is that bad?
Not for us.
She's gonna be in this room all day, by herself in the dark, checking dials.
Poor thing.
Poor thing.
So, we're gonna give her a little surprise.
Boo! Like the Cheshire Cat.
Won't that make her mad?
Let her get mad.
That's half the fun.
But I don't want to make her mad.
Oh, Grace. Do you have to be that way about everything?
One way.
Your teeth. Grace, put some on your teeth.
It ain't like Amalia don't deserve it. She paints more dials than any other girl on the floor. And she can't be bothered to talk to nobody either. You say, Amalia, what's new? And she just looks at you funny.
Well, I don't think she can speak much English.
It wouldn't kill her to smile.
She's coming!
Quick, get the lights!
Where's the switch?
Oh, Catherine! Catherine!
Boom!
Oops.
Mrs. McNeil!
Painting your faces! Have you gone off your minds?
It was just a joke.
Just a joke? A joke that can lose a girl her job?
Now, now, Mrs. McNeil, I'm sure that's not necessary.
I don't tolerate no foolishness, Doctor.
Yeah, foolishness we don't want.
Now, do we?
Mr. Leader, this is the inspection room. All of the dials come here that are painted. And here are some of the girls who should, on the floor, be working. Mr. Leader? These are our girls. Girls, this is Mr. Reeder, my new vice president, and your new plant manager.
And I was just telling Mr. Reeder what a fine bunch of girls we have here. I'm sure now he must think I'm halfway out of my mind.
Mr. Reeder, perhaps you have some words for our girls here. Mrs. McNeil.
Well, girls, this paint you've been playing with, it's very expensive. You realize this. It takes several tons of ore to produce a single gram of radium. That's a lot of work, hard work for the men in the extraction plant, but they do this work gladly. You understand why? Why they work so hard, what we're all working for.
The war?
That's right, the war. The dials you paint save lives, girls. Our boys in the field depend on them. To read them in the dark, no mistaking what they see. Otherwise, some of those boys will not be coming home. So, if you fool around and don't take the work seriously, then you're playing into the hands of the Kaiser. And we don't want that, now do we?
No, sir.
So let's quit fooling around and get back to work.
Mr. Reeder, I just wanted to say, I'm sorry. I won't do nothing like this ever again.
Well, dear, just keep this in mind. If you do right by us, we'll do right by you.
May 17th, 1921. Nancy J. Harlan for the New York Graphic. The New York Graphics only. Grove Reporter.
Jack Youngwood reporting for the New York Ledger. New York's first source for news.
Madame Marie Curie, eminent French scientist, embarks on her whistle-stop tour of the United States.
First stop, New York City, where she is greeted by an enthusiastic crowd of well-wishers.
The High Priestess of Science is headed to Washington to receive a gift of 1 gram of radium valued at $100,000.
Purchased for her by the Marie Curie Radium Club, an association of more than 100,000 American women.
Who each gave $1 in support of humanitarian research with radium.
Oh, Grace, over here. Irene, look! I got my certificate. Member Marie Curie Radium Club. You gave a dollar?
It's all for science.
Science? What about my room and board?
You see that, Charlie? That is a marketing opportunity. Let's send her one of our customers' watches, courtesy the United States Radium Corporation.
We'll need a press release.
Radium isn't just for scientists to study. The average American can share in its glory every night. Luminous watches, luminous clocks. Anyone who thinks that these are just novelties, consider all the other advances in the past 50 years. The electric light, the telegraph.
The telephone.
The automobile. Inventions all once dismissed as novelties or as toys.
Are now essentials to modern life. Got it. That ought to sell some watches.
Well, watches, absolutely. But that's not where the growth is now, Charlie. You heard the lady. It's the medical market.
And Standard Chemical owns it.
Only because Von Sashaki lets them take it. But if we wanted to, we could take half their business. It's just a matter of positioning.
Standard Chemical publishes its own journal. Sends it to 12,000 doctors. We could do something similar.
Something scholarly that the doctors would respect.
A bibliography, listing every article ever published on radium.
But with capsule reports to save the doctors time. They get the information, they find it fast, and they
have us to thank for it.
We'll send it to every doctor in the U.S. Radium Society.
Every doctor in the American Medical Association.
That's the spirit, Charlie. Advertising. It's not just the product.
Thank you.
It's the way you promote it.
Grace, the church was filled with flowers, lilies and carnations and orchids. You know how Amalia loved orchids?
Those weren't orchids.
They were orchids, Irene.
Flags.
Orchids! I know an orchid when I see one. Purple orchids. Oh, and that smell, Grace. That smell, it was like...
Flowers?
No, it was like heaven. I was gonna say it was like heaven.
Like heaven? Catherine, it was just a funeral. You make it out like it was some kind of Valentino picture.
It wasn't just a funeral. It was Amalia's, and it was beautiful. The church sent this big spray of flowers, too. They're carnations.
I thought those were mums.
Yellow carnations?
Mums!
Well, it sounds like a nice service, anyhow.
Girls, the whistle's already gone. Now then, I've received my new instructions this day. We're going back to the old way of pointing brushes. We was losing too much paint in the cloth. But, yes, Grace, is there something you'd wish to say?
Dr. Von Sashaki told me not to do that. He said it's unsanitary.
Unsanitary? Well, I can hardly believe he'd ever say such a thing. We've been doing this for as long as I've been here. You must have misunderstood him.
Yes, ma'am.
And you're not getting new brushes until you've done with the old. And they've got to be so bad you can't get a point no more.
You can't make quota like that.
Well, you'll have to do your best then, since I have my instructions.
I need a new brush.
It's not for us to be asking questions, now is it? It's for us to do the work.
I have my instructions, girls! I have my instructions!
Well, here's an instruction for you, McNeil. Let some of the starch out of your corset.
Was she at the service?
McNeil, are you kidding? Do you think she crossed the street for her own mother?
Most everybody else was, though. You was about the only girl from the floor who wasn't there.
Well, I wanted to come, but Mom was working and I had to watch the little ones.
You could have brought them.
All seven?
Well, if it was me, I'd have tried to get there. Just lay off. Grace feels bad as it is.
But poor Amalia.
Poor Amalia?
Poor kid. Her family took it awful bad, Grace. Albina, Quinta, everybody. Every one of them crying so bad. Even her father. I have never seen a grown man cry before, and not like that. Just bawling like a baby.
And you know why, too.
Because their daughter had died.
What she died from?
Irene, don't go spreading stories.
It's not a story. Albina told us. There's no reason Grace shouldn't know.
Know what? Know what? Amalia?
Ain't it awful? Her father's fit to be tied to. Six girls at home and ain't none of them ever going to a dance again.
And all because Amalia up and died from syphilis.
Shh!
Well, I can't help it if that's what she died from.
You don't know that for sure.
It's on the death certificate.
Anemia and complications from syphilis.
But Amalia was ever so nice.
Guess she got around more than we knew.
Well, maybe it's a mistake. Maybe the doctor got it wrong.
come on.
He could have got it wrong. Doctors are wrong sometimes.
That's true. Doctor's wrong about Aunt Ivy. What's Mama got to do with it? Don't you remember? Up until the day she died, Doctor said Aunt Ivy would be fine. Said, take a cup of tea, get a good night's rest. And 2 days later, we were taking her to Rosedale Cemetery.
Girls! Girls, the gentlemen are here to make an announcement.
Thank you, Mrs. McNeil. Girls, we're here to put a few rumors to rest.
And to explain some changes, yeah?
Right. As you may have heard by now, Dr. Von Sashaki is stepping down, and he wanted to take this moment
to make this goodbye. And Mr. Ritter has kindly consented. Some of you I have known since you were little girls, coming here during the war, working so hard, day after day at the bench, 200, 300, some of you 500 dials a day, so proud to be part of our work here. When this company I start in my own kitchen mixing up the paint, I knew I had found something miraculous to make life better, easier. And now, what do I read? More and more uses there are for the radium. More than I dreamed possible.
Thank you, Doctor.
Yes, thank you, Doctor. Now, girls, the doctor is a busy man and must be on his way. So let's wish him the best of luck in his new business ventures.
And Mr. Reader, let us good luck wish to you also. To the plate he steps as your new company president. Our congratulations to you.
Thank you.
When Mr. Reader came 4 years ago to us, I saw in him a man of great enterprise.
Thank you.
And great ambition.
Yes, thank you.
Little did I guess the direction this ambition would take. But one of the things that makes this country great is the opportunity it presents to a young man and his friends.
And so, girls,
and
let's...
so, ladies, let us wish Mr. Reader the very best in the new direction he intends the company to take.
New direction?
With the slowdown in dial painting.
Now, Doctor...
And business moving into the medical market, there's going to be lots of changes, yeah?
Fine. Well, there you have it, girls, as we're all on the clock. We'll leave you to your work.
Thank you, ladies. My best wishes to you.
That's back to work with you, girls.
Who wants to go out tonight?
I do.
It'll be fun. Irene? Irene?
Irene? Honey, you all right?
I'm fine. Why wouldn't I be?
Your mouth is bleeding.
$35 a week and she quits the place.
More to life than money.
That's what you say when you're young, Tom. But you get to my age with a house full of your kids underfoot, you'll be thanking God for every penny you put by.
We got money put by.
How much?
Enough to get married on.
Don't do much to get married on. Do you have enough to stay married on?
You let us get married and we'll find out.
Are you still eating, Tommy?
It's good.
You're gonna get fat.
Gotta keep up his strength. He works hard for his money.
Don't start, Mom.
I didn't say nothing. It's your father who hit the roof over it.
He didn't hit the roof.
You should have seen the man's face, Tom. When he found out Grace wasn't working no more, most girls would give their eye teeth for a job like that. Good money, easy work, nice-looking fellas around the plant.
You didn't tell me about them, Grace.
Wasn't that many of them. Hardly seemed worth the mention.
And she leaves it all behind, for reasons unknown. I'm tired of it up there, she says. Are you tired of the paycheck, I says? Who needs a paycheck, she says? I got me a boyfriend to take me out on Saturday.
She said that?
Oh, you know I didn't. And for your information, I got a job. I started the bank on Monday.
Oh, yeah. The bank. And what's it pay?
Enough.
Enough. Always enough. You know what that means, Tom? Don't come close to what they pay down at the radium plant.
It's office work.
Office work. Well, I guess that means we'll be spending more money on clothes then. Office work.
Boy, she is really steamed at you.
I don't see what difference it makes as long as I work somewhere.
Don't make no difference to me. I just thought you liked it up there.
Sure, I liked it. I worked there 4 years.
So? I've been delivering mail almost 8 years. I plan to keep on delivering mail another 20 or 30 years, if I'm lucky. Nothing like good work and a steady pension to help you sleep at night.
attention and I sleep just fine.
I bet you do. So how come you quit, Grace?
Lots of girls are quitting. Work is slow. Besides, since Irene left, it's just not as much fun. And wouldn't you rather have a girlfriend who works in a bank?
Not as much as I'd like to have a wife who don't work anywhere.
Close your eyes. I got a surprise for you.
Yeah? You want me to get the shades?
Not that kind of surprise. Close your eyes. Now look.
Wallpaper.
For the baby's room.
Baby's room? You won't kiss me and you're talking about babies?
There's gotta be babies eventually, Tommy.
Well, sure, but you know, Grace, most girls, they get married before they decorate the nursery.
Plan ahead for once. Pick one.
They're both the same.
No, they're not. This one has big flowers and this one has little flowers. So pick one.
This some kind of test?
No, it's just wallpaper.
It is some kind of test.
Pick one, Tommy.
That one.
Really?
The other one, then.
Which do you like, though?
They're both nice.
This one's pretty, don't you think?
That one, then.
But I want you to like it, too.
If you like it, I'll like it. Wallpaper is wallpaper.
Huh, no, it isn't. You gotta pick something you can stand to look at for 20 years.
Same way you pick women?
Keep it up, smarty pants. You won't never get that kiss.
Okay. This one. This one, hands down.
I like it, too. A nice neutral yellow goes with either a boy or a girl. And until the baby comes, you can use the room for other things.
Yeah? Like what?
Like a painting studio, maybe.
A painting studio, maybe? Didn't you get enough of painting at work?
Not the kind I wanted to do, Tommy. I used to paint watercolors at school. And ever since I went to work, I don't have no time. What with watching the kids and helping Ma. And once we get married, I just want some time. Just a little time to myself. So that I can do watercolors. Or oils, maybe. Maybe portraits. In oil. I can paint your picture if you like.
Sure. Paint a big portrait of me and we'll hang it in the outhouse. All our friends will come around just so they can use the can and look at it.
Oh, the way you talk sometimes.
Aw, Grace. You wanna paint pictures? Paint pictures. I ain't gonna stop
you. You say that now, Tommy. But once we're married, you'll change your tune.
Sure. I'll be whistling Dixie.
Wait till you come home some night, all wore out. Some Christmas, maybe. And every customer on your roots had 3 times the mail. And maybe some dog took after you. And some old lady kept you waiting on her stoop, telling you all about her grandchildren. And you didn't have the heart to tell her you can't talk. I know you. So you come home all cranky and late besides, hungry, wanting your dinner. And there I am, with my easel set up in the kitchen, a drop cloth on the floor, my paints all over the table, and your dinner nowhere in sight. What would you say then?
Better be a picture of me you're painting.
I know what you'd say. Where's my dinner? That's what you'd say.
Where's my dinner?
Well, sure, but I'd still admire the painting. Just want to look at it on a full stomach is all. So how'd I do? Pick the right wallpaper?
Oh, I don't know. Maybe I'll go look at stripes.
Stripes, polka dots, I don't care. Let's just get married, Grace. You're plenty old enough. Tell your mom we ain't waiting no more. We'll just run off.
Tommy, we are not running off. We're gonna do it right. A nice church wedding with flowers and music, and then a week at the seashore. Just us. And after that, we get set up in our own place. You'll see. It'll be worth the wait.
Your mouth hurting you?
Yeah. The dentist wants to pull another tooth. In the back.
Oh, well, what's a tooth?
Oh my, do I, honey, honey, do I do. And do I need you? Oh my, do I, honey, honey, do I do.
Hazel Cooser, any connection to the others?
Only by virtue of employment.
Except she's got a good lawyer.
Knows how to write a good letter anyway, that lawyer.
And she no longer works here.
Left 6 months ago.
This makes 4 now.
3.
4 if you count the Maggia girl.
I wouldn't include her.
She worked here.
She also worked other places, and, what she died from, you couldn't pick up here. At least... I don't think you can.
That's not funny, Charlie. And besides, that's just idle talk.
In my experience, there's usually something to the idle talk. when it comes to girls like that.
From a large family, wasn't she?
Italians. The conditions they live in. 10, 12 people in 3 rooms. It's a wonder they don't all die of one infection or another.
3 then. How many dead?
Only Miss Maggia, but I haven't heard from her people yet.
It's too late for her anyway. The statute of limitations is 2 years. Miss Cooser, on the other hand, she's in a position to make some trouble now.
Of all the time I've been here, no one has so much as slipped on the floor. And now this.
We're talking 4 girls out of how many hundreds we've employed.
600, 700 over the years?
And some of them were sick when they got here. One girl you hired was a complete cripple. Couldn't even climb the stairs by herself. Her father carried her up to the studio every morning.
It didn't make a difference to me how she got up those stairs. She was a fast worker and a very sweet little girl.
But she was in poor health.
She needed the work!
Arthur! Charlie!
And not just for the money. To feel productive. To have a purpose. That's what work does, Charlie. It gives us a purpose. I don't see why we should stop hiring girls like that.
When they get sick here and try to blame it on us, you might want to rethink that policy.
Well, let's see what Dr. Drinker has to say about it.
Dr. Drinker?
Some professor from the Harvard School of Industrial Hygiene.
He chairs the department, and he's agreed to take a look at our operations.
Don't you think we're jumping the gun a bit, hiring him?
We have had 6 girls quit this week alone. And Mrs. McNeil tells me that there could be more.
Girls come and go all the time.
Never like this. These girls are terrified. We have to do something to calm them down.
Letting Drinker examine them? That feels like a recipe for mass hysteria.
We'll tell them it's a routine physical. Edward?
Companies give physicals all the time.
Then Drinker's gonna start next month.
In the meantime, I recommend we make an offer to Miss Cooser.
Settle?
There's no proof her problems are connected to us.
But if she sues, believe me, you won't like the press it brings. Neither will the investors.
Do you think this could affect the stock offering?
Don't you?
Wonderful. We'll open at 30 and close at 10.
Or not open at all.
But if we give this girl something, that will keep her quiet.
It'd be a condition of the settlement.
Maybe we'd better do it.
Yeah, but suppose that lawyer has a racket going. He finds sick girls and talks them into making suits. And then we reward him for his larceny?
Unless Miss Cooser genuinely believes that she got sick here.
It could be like Charlie said. She comes from a large immigrant family, not well educated, not a lot of resources.
A few $100 could make a big difference to a girl like that.
Exactly. Buy some medicine, pay a few doctor's bills. From the sound of that letter, doesn't sound like she has long left to live anyway.
So it'd be a gesture of decency then.
Exactly.
What do you think we should offer?
March 24, 1924, Jack Youngwood reporting for the New York Ledger.
Nancy Jane Harlan for the New York Graphic, the New York Graphic's only girl reporter.
Could radium water pose a cure for crippling arthritis? Scientific studies suggest a connection.
Dateline, Orange, New Jersey. Radium water poses as a miracle cure for crippling arthritis.
Some patients reported significant abatement in their symptoms.
Mrs. Jeremy Michaels of the Bronx tells how radium water transformed her life.
My pain got so bad I couldn't hardly bend over.
While others reported only mild relief.
This poor, brave woman could not even bend down to kiss her little ones goodnight.
And I got 3, let me tell you, they are a handful of-
Dr. Harrison Marlin, chief medical examiner for Essex County, commented on the study.
Preliminary at best.
Your recommendations, Dr. Marlin?
Why advise further study?
Then Mrs. Michaels tried Radithor.
They said it would help my rheumatism, so I drank a bottle a month for a week. And then I scrubbed the kitchen floor and counter just like I always done.
Dr. William J.A. Bailey of Orange, inventor of Radithor, reports strong demand for his product.
Dr. William Bailey of Orange announces sales of Radithor exceed 100,000 worldwide.
Radioactivity is one of the most remarkable substances known to man. Why, I drink Radithor myself, and I can vouch for its power.
A bottle a day.
And $1 a bottle?
Worth every penny.
Yes, indeed. Why, I myself was the picture of lethargy before I discovered the amazing, vitalizing properties of radium water. Now look at me. I'm nearly 50 years old, but I move like a man in his
30s. You'd rather look like a man in his 30s.
Why, thank you.
A testament to the tonic's potency?
Word of the seller's creativity.
Radithor! It's perpetual sunshine!
And a perpetual money machine for its inventor.
Is there no end to what science
can do?
appointment.
But it's a busy place, Catherine. If you don't have an appointment, maybe you should make one.
I shouldn't need no appointment for this.
I'm sorry, I couldn't find anything under Schwab.
No, it's under Rudolph.
Rudolph?
The girl I'm asked about? I mean Rudolph.
Did she file the complaint?
No, the dentist did.
The dentist?
Dr. Neff, Irene's dentist. He said she might have phossy jaw and was going to file a complaint to the health department. But when I asked him about it, he said he hadn't heard nothing. And it's been more than 6 months now.
Phossy jaw, you say?
Yes.
Catherine, it could have been like your doctor said. A blood infection.
Yeah, but what gave it to her? That's the thing. What was it from?
From dirt. You get infections from dirt.
From dirt? Her face puffed up like a pumpkin. Her jaw got it so bad she couldn't eat nothing. You think you get that from dirt? You get it from phosphorus. They're saying it's radium in the paint, but it's really phosphorus that makes it glow.
Oh, honestly, Catherine, you can't really believe that.
You saw her, Grace.
Catherine, if it was like you say, they'd have never let you work up there in the first place.
Sure, they'd have shut the place down.
Shut it down? Who? Who's gonna shut it down?
Oh, I don't know. The county?
Honestly, Grace, you're such a ninny.
Hey!
How are they gonna shut it down if they don't even know about it?
Now, come on!
Never mind that!
It's all right, Tommy. She's just upset.
Upset? She's gone round the bend. She probably thinks they're putting arsenic in the drinking water. Next, it'll be their kidnapping babies and using them to start the furnace.
Laugh all you want. But you won't be laughing so hard when it's 6 months from now, and you're asking about Grace.
Oh, for crying out loud.
Catherine, it's just a toothache.
Yeah? That's how it started for Irene. Just a toothache. You wait, Grace, you wait. You'll wake up one morning and you're... gums will hurt so bad, you won't be able to close your mouth. The pain's so bad, you'll be able to stand
stop
up.
It,
you'll
Catherine.
Be so weak and sick, you'll be able to sleep. And your face will be so swollen, you'll be able to stand
it.
Beside of yourself.
Grace is fine. Right, Gracie?
Irene Rudolph?
That's it.
She worked at the radium plant.
Yes, ma'am.
Nothing.
Huh?
The company is in full compliance with all state labor and health regulations. They ordered an analysis of the paint.
Oh, you see that?
Miss, really?
Who's Miss Young?
That's the health officer, miss.
Paint is a harmless compound of radium and zinc?
As I was saying, the analysis shows that there was no phosphorus in the paint. There was no phosphorus anywhere in the plant.
There, you see, Catherine.
Miss Young toured the plant herself. She found nothing amiss. I'm sorry.
Well, guess we can get some lunch then.
I'm gonna file another complaint.
They already did an investigation.
I'm gonna file another complaint.
Oh, brother.
I just don't see what good this is gonna do, Catherine, to make such a fuss this way.
I'm gonna file another complaint.
Catherine, these folks, they're awful busy here.
Grace, you saw her. 3 surgeries and they wanted to cut her. She finally said no. She knew what was left of her jaw rotted so bad. And the smell was terrible. And Grace, the worst of it is, Irene was so afraid of being left alone. But I left her alone. When she died, it was the middle of the night. And nobody was with her.
Ma'am! I'm sorry. Can we have another form? My friend would like to file another complaint.
Another complaint? Is the girl still sick?
No. She died.
Wait right here.
See your grandfather?
No. But I can see the schoolhouse.
You think this is funny?
Well, she's enjoying herself.
Harriet!
I'll tell you what. If she has no one to shout to, she won't shout.
You can hear her all over the neighborhood.
Can they?
When she comes down here, I want you to speak with her.
She is 9 years old, Diane.
I'm trying to raise a daughter, not a son.
And time's on your side. In another year or two, she'll lose all interest in trees. And develop a fascination with boys.
That's supposed to scare me.
Yeah, and when that day comes, you'll be frantic because she no longer wants to climb trees.
What's this?
Something to give you vitality.
You think I need vitality?
That's what it says in the bottle.
Is it pure?
We're her supplier. Want to try some?
If it'll give me vitality, how can I refuse? So, your father came by to see me today.
Another hard luck case.
Yes. Four children at home, all under the age of six.
Let me guess. Wife in the hospital with cancer.
Yes.
And the husband's been laid off from, let's see, the brickyard.
Yes.
Through no fault of his own.
How did you know?
Dad came around to see me yesterday. It's never enough with him just to have ordinary ambitions. You gotta have a mission in life.
And you do.
No, I have a business plan.
You're telling me you wouldn't help this man if you could?
If I could, but I can't just give him a job that doesn't exist.
Well, what about Dan Lehman?
Dan?
Maybe he could use some help.
In the lab? No. Dan needs trained technicians, not some bricklayer. Why don't you send him to Mrs. Middleton? Don't you women have a social club for things like this?
You mean the Women's Club Civics Committee?
Yeah.
Yes, the club takes an interest in such cases, but we're not an employment service either, which is why I thought you could help him.
Oh, you do love being married to the company president.
It has its advantages.
You ever thought about trading it in?
Do you?
I'll tell you what. I was getting my shoes shined this morning, and while I was sitting there, watching the boy work, I thought, this is quite an enterprise. Work walks in, work walks out. No inventory, no warehouses, no health inspections, no stock prices.
And you trade it all in for your own shoeshine stand.
There'd be fewer headaches that way.
So you're in one of those moods again. What is it this time? It can't be the stock market, it went up today.
So now you're reading the financial pages.
Well, I have to entertain myself somehow. So what happened today? You're being very strange.
Am I? I'm sorry.
You can tell me, you know.
There's nothing to tell, really. This is gonna be our best year ever.
Oh, so it's the prospect of success that you find so disheartening.
Okay, fine. I'll get my checkbook.
What for?
Your bricklayer.
Artie, he needs a job, not charity. What is it that your father always says? A working man needs to work.
It wears on his soul not to work. All right, well, if it's a matter of his soul, then that's different. All right, I'll have him talk to Dan.
Artie.
But I make no promises, Diane.
No promises.
To your health.
How long have you had this drainage?
A week or two. Hurts something awful, Dr. Neff.
Is anything else bothering you?
Back hurts some, too.
You're back now. You see a regular doctor about that?
He says it's nerves.
Nerves?
About my wedding and all.
This ain't no case of nerves, Miss Fryer. I hope you told him that.
What do you think?
I think you better schedule that surgery.
Couldn't we put it off a little till after my wedding?
You put off that surgery, you won't have no wedding. Miss Fryer, I want you to listen to me very carefully. Your jawbone is decaying. That's the black pus oozing out of your gums. It's the bone itself.
That's impossible.
To Mr. Arthur Reeder, U.S. Radium Corporation, Cecil Drinker, Harvard University, encloses our report.
Finally.
We believe the trouble in your plant is due to the radium.
The radium?
It can't be as bad as all that.
This can't be.
Look, you put off that surgery and you will develop a septic condition. Could be fatal.
The blood changes in your employees can be explained on no other grounds.
Everything I've got, I've saved for my wedding.
Photographic films carried by your employees show heavy fog.
Well, I got a suggestion for you.
And we suspect high levels of gamma radiation throughout the plant.
Go to the plant. Explain your situation.
Go to the company?
We realize no proof can be offered at present.
Only see what kind of shape you're in.
This is impossible.
They gotta feel obligated to help you out.
But in view of the material in the literature...
Wait, it's a mistake.
And the facts disclosed by our investigation...
You got a moral obligation.
We recommend immediate and drastic remedial action.
Look, if you want, I'll write to them for you. They can work through me. You pay my bills directly.
You think they'd do that?
Charlie!
They got a moral obligation.
I guess so.
Here, if you want. We can do it right now. I'll get paper.
He has to be wrong. That's it. He's wrong. Charlie, he has to be wrong.
He must have overlooked something.
If we're suffering from a new ailment caused by the radium, it should occur generally throughout the plant.
One would expect.
Several hundred milligrams are in solution at all time in the big vats. Several hundred in ore, there's several hundred in crystallizing.
The entire backyard is filled with tailings.
It's present in good amount all over the property.
If it's the radium, then the incidence of illness should be highest in the laboratory.
And no one there is sick.
Perhaps it's some combination of the radium with the zinc.
Or something peculiar to our plant alone.
Some kind of bacteria, perhaps, in the brushes.
It can't be the radium. There are dozens of application plants all over the country, and no one has ever reported anything like this.
The Department of Labor wants to see the report.
Yes. I'm aware.
What are we going to do? This tears us to pieces. How do we answer them?
They want to see the report? We'll send them this.
One page?
The most important page.
Drinker will never stand for this.
Drinker works for us. This is a proprietary report. What we do with it is our business.
But the Department of Labor, Arthur.
We just need time, Charlie. Just a little time.
They could shut us down for this.
Scientists or government men? They don't know what it takes to run a business. Von Sashaki thought advertising was some dirty word. He laughed at the very idea of promotion. I can't tell you how many times I walked into that man's office and he turned a deaf ear to everything I told him. But Charlie, we showed him, we are the world's largest single supplier of radium, the largest in the world. Do you know what it took for us to get here? Do you think I'm gonna stand idly by and watch as they drag our good name through the mud? Trust me, Charlie.
You to come all this way.
Not at all, my dear. Not at all.
I told my surgeon he was coming over here, so he gave me the results of my blood work.
Excellent.
And so?
I must say, Miss Fryer, your blood looks better than mine.
It does?
That's what happens to an old man who smokes. Now tell me, what else is troubling you?
My feet and my back, mostly. I've had to wear a brace for a while.
So I see. And this started before you left the company, or after?
After I left. Dr. Neff says this all has to do with the radium plant. I know another girl that died from it. Irene Rudolph?
Oh, yes. Terrible thing. Vincent's angina.
What's that?
That's an ulcerated condition of the mouth, my dear.
From the radium?
Oh, no. An unfortunate and rare result of poor dental care. Let this be a lesson to you. Always brush your teeth.
There was something else about this, in the paper, about other girls that got sick. One girl I worked with for a while. She's in the hospital in New York and the doctors don't know what to do. They've never seen anything like it.
Miss Fryer, don't tell me you pay attention to what's printed in the papers. Those stories are not scientific.
But
reporters are not scientific. They do not follow scientific methods. A reporter writes to sell, not to educate. The scientist is not concerned with what sells. He is concerned with the truth. He undertakes years of painstaking study to arrive at an understanding of intricate natural processes that most people can never presume to comprehend. You would do well to listen to science and ignore the nonsense that is printed in the papers. Because I can assure you right now, radium has nothing to do with what's ailing you.
It doesn't?
Not in the least.
Then what is ailing me?
Poor diet, Miss Fryer. Poor diet.
But Dr.
Neff is a dentist, not a physician. What you have is a vitamin deficiency. You must eat more fresh fruit.
Hard to do in the winter.
And raw meat as well. That will help the anemia. Raw calf's liver particularly. Cook it if you must, but eat it twice a week at a minimum. No, Miss Fryer. I am a scientist, and I take a purely scientific interest in this situation. By allowing me to examine you, you are helping me to further my own studies. I thank you. Call me anytime, day or night.
Okay, Dr. Flynn. Thanks.
Happy to be of service, my dear.
Dr. Frederick Flynn,
PhD, Physiology, Columbia University. PhD?
My findings, Mr. Rita.
That's not a real doctor!
He's seen half a dozen girls who used to work for the plant. Word I hear, he's working for the factory.
An objective evaluation, I trust.
The source of my funding has no bearing on my research.
And I let that fella examine me.
I never examined her. It was not a medical examination.
But nevertheless, you were able to offer her some useful advice.
I did my best.
Every girl he sees, it's the same thing. Nothing wrong with you.
Your blood is better than mine, he says.
And how are you doing with the rest of the report?
The animal studies I conducted reveal no adverse effects from the radium. The problem, as you suspected, is one of poor personal hygiene only.
I can't believe somebody would do that! Straight up lie to you like that!
Nothing surprises me.
It's exactly the way you said, Catherine. Those people will say anything. They'll do anything.
Except the right thing.
Well, we're gonna make them, Catherine. We're gonna make sure someone hears about this.
I am most grateful, Dr. Flynn. But I'm particularly happy to hear that the young lady you examined is doing so much better.
I never examined her. Oh, no, no, no. It was merely a consultation.
Ah, well, the same. She is doing much better, though, isn't she?
From what I can see, Mr. Rita, she appears to be on the road to recovery.
That's excellent.
Here is the statement of my fees and expenses.
Mr. Lee will draw you a check.
And so I leave you now with this one thought. Ladies and gentlemen, we do not have to accept injustice. We can use our power as consumers to influence the practices of those who would wish to profit from our patronage. Thank you.
Thank you, Miss Wiley. And thank you to the New Jersey Consumers League for another job well done. This concludes our program for this evening. Please join us next door for some light refreshments.
You want anything?
My throat's a little dry.
Can I help you, miss?
I'm here to see Miss Wiley.
You're not a member of the Woman's Club.
No, ma'am.
Are you a guest of a member?
No, ma'am.
Then I am sure Miss Wiley will be happy to assist you during your normal business hours.
I'm not leaving till I see Miss Wiley.
It's all right, Mrs. Middleton. It's fine. You must be Miss Fryer.
Yes, ma'am. Miss Young at the health department said I should see you. I know I should have stopped by your office, but I missed a lot of work lately and I didn't want to miss no more.
No need to apologize. I've been meaning to call on you myself. Please, sit down.
Me and Catherine, we wrote to the company about our troubles, but we never heard anything. So then we went to see a couple lawyers, but they all said they can't do anything because it's been so long since we left the radium plant. Something about the law won't allow it.
The statute of limitations.
Right. And one lawyer, he said he'd try to sue anyhow. Only he wants $1,000 up front. And I've already spent everything I saved on my wedding on doctors and dentists and hospitals. And I still don't know what's wrong, exactly. And Tom, that's my fella, he says he don't care. He wants to get married anyhow. But I just wonder, what good would I do him like this, Miss Wiley? If I could just get some compensation, then I could settle my debts, and maybe I wouldn't feel like I was saddling Tom with such a burden. I'm sorry to rattle Auntie about these things, but I'm just so tired of being pushed around.
I don't blame you.
Miss Young at the health department, she said the Consumers League has, what did she say, clout?
I'd like to think so. We've certainly had our share of successes.
Can you help us, then?
Tell me, Miss Fryer, just how far are you willing to go with this?
Ma'am?
Suppose I do find a lawyer willing to take your case. Someone willing to take it on a contingency. You wouldn't have to pay him unless you won. Would you be willing to sue?
I want my compensation.
Of course you do. Now suppose the company says, here is some money for you, Miss Fryer, only you are to tell no one what we've agreed to. You are to say nothing about how you got sick.
Keep it quiet, you mean?
Yes.
That don't seem right.
It isn't right, but that's what they'll do. They will try to buy your silence. Is it for sale?
Miss Fryer?
No. No, ma'am. It isn't.
Good.
Can you help us, then?
I think I can help you, if you're willing to take some chances.
Chances?
Miss Fryer, if you would be willing to set aside your own need just for a moment, we could put a stop to that company. We could stop them dead in their tracks.
What do I have to do?
We start by putting you on page one.
Page one? You want her to talk to a newspaper?
Not just one newspaper. Many, many newspapers.
Is that really necessary? All we want is for Grace to get her compensation.
Tommy! Let her finish.
I understand your concerns. But this company has already shown it's willing to go to extremes to protect itself. No, I'm afraid the only way we'll get to them is to hit them where it matters most. Their public image. When every newspaper in America tells your story. How you were sorely treated, how you suffered, how the company denied all responsibility. Believe me, Miss Fryer, when that happens, Arthur Reeder will come to the table with his hat in his hands.
All right, Miss Wiley.
I know it's a little frightening.
It's okay. Right now I'm more angry than I am scared.
Good. You hang on to that anger, Miss Fryer. You're going to need it.
Jack Youngwood reporting for the New York Ledger.
Nancy Jane Harlan for the New York Graphic.
On the strange case of the Radium Girls.
Who claim they were poisoned at the hands of their employer.
And now seek their day in court.
$250,000?
That's the price tag on their suffering.
$250,000?
Ask me, it's all a sham.
What do you mean? Those girls are very sick.
Sick of working, sure.
The doctors say the Radium Girls only have a year to live.
Only 1 year to live and 250 grand to spend.
What would you do with that kind of money?
What would you do to ease your last suffering days on Earth? What would you do with $250,000?
I'd buy a wardrobe like Irene Castle.
I'd give it all to charity.
Then I'd travel around the world, first class, with all my friends.
I'd play the stock market.
I would buy my wife a fur coat and a diamond the size of New Hampshire.
I'd use it to pay off my medical bills and pay off the second mortgage on our house. The one my father took out to pay for my last operation.
Pretty Grace Fryer sits at home.
Suffering bravely through this entire ordeal.
Struggling valiantly to keep up her flagging spirits.
For the sake of her family and her friends.
It hurts to smile, but I try to smile. I know if I don't smile, I'll go crazy.
Tell us, Miss Fryer, how does it feel knowing you have so little time left?
I try not to think about it.
But it must get to you sometime.
I mean, knowing what you've been through.
And the company getting fat off your labor.
All they have to say about it is...
No comments!
Don't you just want to punch somebody?
Oh, no. That won't do no good. I try to think about how it's gonna be. When justice prevails, then I can do something nice for my folks. Maybe send them on a trip. They never did have no honeymoon.
What a fine example of womanhood. We can only aspire to bear our cross in life as this young woman.
Mr. Barry must object to these kind of histrionics.
I had nothing to do with that, Mr. Markley.
I've been in this business a long time, and when I see a story like this move over the wires, I am not so naive as to believe that a plaintiff's attorney had nothing to do with it.
What's your proposal, Mr. Markley?
$1,500 for each girl.
$1,500?
That's not even a year's wages.
We think it's very generous considering your case won't survive the statute of limitations.
This is a case in equity, sir. The Chancery Court will come to a different conclusion.
But the Chancery Court can't rewrite the law, and the law is clear. 2 years from the date of injury, your clients are out of time.
2 years from the date the cause of injury has been discovered.
Very clever, Mr. Barry. Very creative. I admire your imagination. but you've still a long way to go before you can convince the judge.
And in the meantime, Mr. Markley, the press will continue to take a great interest in this story and the company's complete indifference to its workers.
No doubt this will prove good press for the Consumers League as well, and you accuse us of exploiting these girls.
I'm not the one hiding behind the statute of limitations.
Hiding, Miss Wiley.
You knew very well the law never anticipated a situation like this. These girls were dying years before anyone knew the cause.
Before anyone knew? Does that include the U.S. Radio Corporation, Miss Wiley? When, or should I say if, this case goes to court, I only hope that's her opening argument. You will have made our defense. See you at the hearing.
The arrogance of that man!
Tell me again the purpose of these articles, Miss Wiley.
Public sympathy, Mr. Barry. That's the engine of reform.
You are antagonizing the company.
Then the strategy is working.
And what about the girls? How does it help them to read in dozens of different newspapers that they have so little time to live?
Mr. Barry, surely you can see. The U.S. Radium Corporation cares nothing for the girls it has poisoned. But the average housewife in Orange cares very deeply, as do millions of women across the country. These women shop. They buy watches. Markley can be as smug as he likes, but the Consumers League campaign will lead to only one outcome, and he knows it. That's why he was here today.
I only hope you're right, Miss Wiley.
Public sympathy, Mr. Barry. Wait and see.
Dear Miss Schwab, I read of your sad story in the Boston Globe, and I'm so sorry for your plight. It seems in this age of rapid advancement, the well-being of the average worker has been overlooked. That is why I would like to share with you girls the key to my own good health at the age of 92. It is called Christian Science.
Dear Miss Fryer, I've read of your woeful situation in the Atlanta Constitution, and I'm prepared to offer you a solution. Venicine, a wonder tonic made from all natural ingredients. Venicine can restore your health and vitality. We are prepared to offer you girls a lifetime supply of Venicine in exchange for the exclusive rights to use your pictures in our advertisements.
Dear girl, I read about you in the Billings Gazette. I run 100 head of cattle up north and do very well for myself. I've always longed for a companion, and I'm well equipped to offer you a comfortable home in your final hours. A girl like you has suffered so much. Don't you think you deserve a few fleeting moments of happiness? Sincerely, your admirer, Leonard F. Watkins. P.S. Enclosed are my pictures.
Look at this, Catherine. This man actually sent a picture. You all right, Catherine?
Bleeding again.
Shall I get the nurse?
I did this before. It'll stop.
Maybe we should go.
No, don't go.
Don't you need to sleep?
Who can sleep? I never sleep.
Well, you'll sleep tomorrow.
Yeah. Might not wake up.
Of course you'll wake up.
Not if it don't go so well. Sometimes you don't come out of it so good. My mother's cousin, she went to the hospital for her appendix, and she didn't come home again.
Well, you just can't think that way. That's all. Look at this mail, Catherine. Miss Wiley said folks would be on our side, and she sure was right. Here's one from California.
What if we don't win?
Of course we'll win.
But what if we don't? My father will lose everything. We'll be on the street. You'll be on the street, too. Your father must owe thousands.
Catherine, please.
And you and Tom will never get married. How can you stand it, Grace?
Catherine.
How can Tom stand it? I don't never hear him complain.
As soon as the judge hears our testimony, he's gonna rule for us. All they gotta do is take one look at us. It'll be over in a day.
Think so?
Sure. When they see what kind of shape we're in, we'd be awful hard to ignore. Don't you think?
That'll be something then, to see the look on Mr. Reeder's face when we finally get to the stand.
Now, you wanna read some more letters?
They didn't have no vanilla, so I got some chocolate.
Took you long enough.
Don't get on me. I had 6 people stop me on the way over here. All of them reporters and all of them asking after you.
Waited for me to die.
No one is waiting for you to die.
It's true. One of them called my mother, as if I had died, and when he said no, she sounded disappointed.
Try to eat a little of this. You'll feel better.
Evening, girls! How about a picture?
For the love of Mike, what are you doing?
We're here to get some pictures for the graphics exclusive on the girls.
Exclusive? What are you talking about?
$5,000, that's what... What do you say, Grace? That sound good to you? Think you could use $5,000?
I don't understand.
Perhaps you've heard of Bernard McFadden.
Who, that faith healer?
Herbalist, Mr. Kreider, herbalist. Bernard McFadden's patented herbal therapy is just the thing to get you girls back on your feet. And the graphic will pay for all of it. All we ask is the exclusive rights to the girl's story from here on out. See for yourself.
You want to pay us to go see Bernard McFadden?
Easy money, huh? Let me see that.
They're serious, Grace.
The graphic always does their business on the up and up.
I don't know.
Grace, what does your father owe on the house?
I don't know exactly.
And that last hospital bill, that's gotta be a couple hundred at least.
At least.
Maybe we should think about this.
And all we do is talk to the herbalist fella?
Of course we'll have to get our money's worth with a regular series of features, with pictures following the course of the treatment, your illness, recovery, or otherwise, depending on how it goes.
And then you print whatever you want.
We may add some color. Everybody adds color.
It don't sound so bad.
It just don't feel right.
Maybe we should talk to Miss Wiley about it.
Miss Wiley? What's to her? You're the ones with bills to pay.
It just doesn't seem right to do something like this without talking to Miss Wiley.
You're a big girl, Grace. Can't you make your own decisions?
Of course I can make my own decisions.
You'd take it if it came from the company?
The company owes us a lot more than that.
If you ever see it.
Grace, maybe we should do it.
I don't know.
You're gonna talk to them reporters anyhow. Might as well get something out of it.
He's right, you know. Why should you give your story away when people are crazy to read it? Believe me, you girls could cash in big. The day we ran the feature on you, bang! Sold out of every copy in every newsstand. Everybody can sympathize with the plight of some poor, sick girl facing certain death with no hope of fulfillment in motherhood.
I'd like you to go now. My friend is tired. She needs her rest.
Grace, at least think about it.
Sure. Think it over. I understand. You're worried about what people will say, but hey, you gotta think about your own interests here. There is no reason you shouldn't get something out of all of this. Look out for number one. That's the way. Everybody else is out to get what they can for sure. Why should you sit back and keep your nose clean? When everybody else is up to their elbows in it.
Gentlemen, I've treated a number of girls who claim they got sick here. One of them, the girl's jaw rotted so bad, I removed it just by lifting the bone out of her mouth, as you can see.
That's all right, Dr. Neff. You can put that away now.
Perhaps you'd rather see it on the x-rays, Mr. Reader. This was an expensive case to treat, and I never got compensated. Girl died. Her family never paid.
I sympathize, Dr. Neff. But what has that got to do with us?
Here it is straight. There are going to be more and more girls coming out and saying they got sick here. So maybe we can do business, Mr. Reader. I scratch your back, you scratch mine, that sort of thing.
I'm not following you.
Suppose you was to give me a list of all the girls who worked here. I'd see to it there were no more lawsuits.
You think you could cure them?
Heavens no, Mr. Reader. I'm saying, I scratch your back, you scratch mine.
How so, Dr. Nat?
Well, I'd examine them for radium necrosis, but I'd come up with a more favorable diagnosis. Pyorrhea, say, or something else. Quite a few of them will die a natural death anyway. And the rest we can put off until the statute of limitations kicks in. It's too late to sue.
You're convinced then they don't have a case against the company?
Exactly. And if it did come to court, I'll testify it was some other problem. It'd be strong testimony coming from the dentist who treated them.
And what makes you so sure that these girls will come to you?
Mr. Reno, they'll flock to me if I don't charge them nothing.
Because we'd be paying you.
Exactly right. We understand each other, Mr. Reader.
What exactly are you asking for, Dr. Neff?
I want $10,000 for my trouble so far. And for every girl I agree to see from here on out, $2 a visit. Plus fees for x-rays. I'm suggesting a gentleman's agreement here, Mr. Reader. Better off not in writing.
No.
Fine, we'll put it in writing.
We'll do nothing of the kind. Your proposal is immoral, and we'll have nothing to do with it.
Immoral, you say? You're a fine one to be talking about morals.
Mr. Lee!
You got your own hired guns ready to testify.
Those are expert witnesses.
Those are not expert witnesses, Mr. Reader. Those are paid lackeys. And none of them's got the dirt that I got. Look, if you're smart, you'll play ball with me. Believe me, there are plenty of folks interested in my information.
You're threatening me.
Not at all, Mr. Reader. It's just a business proposition. I only look out for my interests the same way you look after yours.
Mr. Lee! See Dr. Neff to the door.
Okay, all right. You don't want to play ball, fine. But believe me, when this all shakes out, it won't be me holding the short end of the stick.
Ladies and gentlemen, I want you all to write a statement about what happened here today. And then we'll send it to the State Dental Society. Neff will see who's playing ball and who isn't.
An excellent idea.
I don't know. Perhaps we shouldn't be too quick to dismiss Neff's proposal.
What do you mean?
We are in a very bad situation here, Mr. Reader.
That's true. Mr. Lee says you're having trouble getting girls to work here.
Yes, and we've lost some contracts because of it.
And it's going to get worse.
The papers are filled with stories about those girls.
Making them out to be saints.
And what defense can we put out?
Except to say that we'll try our case in court.
And in the court of public opinion, we've already lost.
Perhaps we should reconsider. It certainly wouldn't hurt to have testimony from the dentist who treated those girls.
Yes, Neff could be very helpful to us. We should retain him.
Retain him as what? Some extortionist?
As an expert.
Like Dr. Flynn.
Dr. Flynn is a highly respected professor at Columbia University. Neff is some neighborhood dentist.
But Dr. Flynn treated some of those girls, didn't he?
He didn't treat them. He consulted with them.
He dispensed medical advice, Arthur.
It wasn't medical advice, Charlie. It was an expert's opinion, a scientific opinion.
How about this? We retain Neff, but we don't put him on the stand to keep him from testifying to those women.
That's the most important part.
Yes, I agree. That's the most important thing.
Would you agree to something like that, Mr. Reader?
Mr. Reader?
Mr. Reader.
Edward, we can't possibly do this. We can't possibly get into bed with a guy like Neff.
Arthur's right. We don't want to do business with Neff.
He could hurt us.
We have to take steps.
Neff has already given us everything we need. New evidence, gentlemen. This is grounds for a postponement.
Three months to study an x-ray? It's outrageous. And the girls. Did you see the girls? Their eyes were like saucers, looking at me, terrified.
Mr. Barry!
How are they going to hold out three more months? Catherine Schaub could barely make it into the courtroom today. And Grace, she was trying so hard not to cry. And of course I had all the answers. Go home, girls, get some rest. That's the best I could do. Go get some
rest. You're doing wonderfully,
Mr. Barry. I don't understand people like Markley. And Reader? How can they play this kind of game with the poor girl sitting right there?
Maybe this will
help. You think the company would be eager to resolve this, given all the kind of publicity it has gotten? But Markley seems to enjoy the sport of it, of what he can get away with. It's cold, very cold.
Mr. Barry.
What's this?
It's from Catherine Drinker. Mrs. Cecil Drinker of Harvard? She's an industrial hygienist also. She worked with Dr. Drinker on his study of the radium plant. It was a joint effort, actually.
That's very interesting, Miss Wiley, but we've already seen that document. There's nothing from it that can help us.
You've only seen part of it. Mr. Barry, please. This is the complete report. I received it this morning. Mrs. Drinker has been following our story very closely in the newspapers and was particularly disturbed to read that last article in the letter. The one where Mr. Lee says her study clears the company.
He doctored the report. Reader doctored the report.
Apparently, he pulled out a page listing the blood conditions of a dozen employees and passed off as the whole thing. Doesn't look so bad by itself, does it? But in context, it's a somewhat different picture.
We can use this.
Yes, this should impress the judge.
The judge, Miss Wiley, I'm not going to wait 3 months to make use of this. I want you to call that contact you have at the New York World. If Reader won't let us present our evidence in the courtroom, then he can read about it in the paper. January 12th, 1928, Jack Youngwood reporting for the New York Ledger.
Nancy Jane Holland for the New York Graphic, the New York Graphics only, girl reporter.
Radium girls go to court today.
Radium girls knock at the door of justice. Will they be heard?
These poor girls face pain.
Disfigurement.
Ruin.
And death. And as the clock ticks away at their precious moments,
a hearing begins in Chancery Court,
where the U.S. Radium Corporation demands postponement.
As plaintiff's attorney Raymond Berry makes a shocking disclosure,
showing that the company lied to the Department of Labor,
showing that it distorted the results of a Harvard study,
concealing the ill effects of its products.
Read all about it in the Ledger.
Read it in the Graphic. We care because you care.
Very bad.
You didn't read it?
I make a point not to these days.
If only other people would do the same. Mrs. Mitchell from across the street, she walked right past me this morning. I know she saw me. She didn't say a word. And everyone at the greengrocer and the market, the way they all glance at each other, and Mrs. Middleton and the other ladies at the club, the whispers.
Why don't you put that away? Read the journal. I saw it here the other day.
At the club today, someone actually had the nerve to say to me, "Is it true? Is it true? Did your husband poison all those women?" And I said, "Mrs. Cowles, if you really think that is true, then why would you speak with me at all? I certainly would not associate myself with women whose husbands did such horrible things."
Then why do you go there then, if that's the way people are there?
I've been a member for years.
What do you want me to say, Diane? I knew we were poisoning people, but we were just making too much money that we didn't want to stop. Is that what you want me to say?
I certainly don't want you to say such things.
Even if it were true? Or especially if it were true?
Is it true?
Is that what you think?
What would you like me to think?
For God's sake, Diane! Don't you see what's going on here? It's Von Sashaki. He's behind all of this. He's feeding information to the Consumers League so they can railroad
Why
us.
Why would the Consumers League?
Radical women, do-gooders, half of them are Reds, probably. Socialists. Same thing with that club you belong to.
What?
You women think you can go around and fix the world's problems.
I can't.
While your
I'm
husbands
sorry.
Go out and make a living. You're gonna quit that club.
Quit the club?
And stop talking to that idiot Mrs. Middleton.
You're not making
She doesn't
any
know
sense.
Anything. None of these women know anything. You don't know anything!
Did you lie to the Department of Labor?
What?
Did you lie?
I didn't lie. I didn't agree with Drinker's results.
Arthur!
I have a fiduciary duty to the company.
I can't listen to this.
Diane, I have documents, articles, people with tumors the size of baseballs with the radium. The tumors disappear, Diane.
I'm tired. I'm going upstairs.
We save lives. We make lives better. You can't possibly think I'm a liar, can you? You can't possibly think I would set out to poison these people. Can you? Diane?
No.
You don't think I would do anything to hurt you? Or to hurt Harriet?
Certainly not.
Then?
13 girls have died.
People die every day. In the newspapers, death notices. Old, young, infants. Children younger than Harriet die every day.
But these women worked for you.
And they also worked other places. I have an expert in industrial hygiene, the same as Drinker, from Columbia University, who says that there's no connections between these illnesses and our plants. Would you like to see the articles?
Ben, what else could the cause be?
I don't know. We've done everything we could to figure it out, and I don't know. Please say you believe me. If you don't believe me, there's no point to any of this.
Artie.
You remember that day I told my father I wasn't going into the ministry? What you said to me that day?
You can do as much good in a boardroom as you can do in a church.
You remember?
You think I would forget?
I was such a scared kid. And he was an icon. If it weren't for you, I don't think I could have stood up to him.
I'm sure you would have, Artie. I know you would have.
And ever since that day, he's been looking for signs that my soul is lost. You don't believe that, do you? That my soul is lost?
You're a good man, Artie.
We save lives, Diane.
You save lives.
It's all been for you. You know that, don't you? Everything I've done, it's always been for you.
I know.
Arthur!
Is that Mr. Lee?
For God's sake, Charlie!
I just got off the phone with someone from the ledger.
They couldn't wait until morning?
I'm sorry. Good evening.
Mr. Lee.
It's Dr. Lehman.
Dan?
He's dead, Arthur.
What?
He died this morning.
Charlie, that's impossible. I just saw him last week.
They were just here for cards last month. They were just here.
Martlin's already done an autopsy. He said it was severe anemia.
He's blaming the radium.
The ledger is going to run it on page one. I told the reporter, we should issue a statement by 8 tonight. That's when he needs it, so it can run tomorrow.
When are the services?
I'm sorry?
The services!
I don't know.
We'll send flowers. Diane?
Yes, I'll go. Call Louise.
Okay, that's good. Call Louise.
Poor Louise. We should go over and see her right now.
I wouldn't do that.
Why ever not?
She's planning to sue.
Louise?
The reporter from the ledger told me. She's filing a wrongful death action. I've worked up a statement for the papers. Company chemist for 8 years, always in poor health, recently in decline.
But Dan was never sickly. He was always out on the golf course or sailing or out in his garden. He kept a beautiful garden, Artie.
Charlie, can we talk about this in the morning?
Of course. I'm sorry to bring you the bad news, Mrs. Reeder. Good night.
Good night, Mr. Lee.
Charlie can be a bit excessive at times. We have to say something. The shareholders are going to expect it. I don't know what we'll say, but we have to say something.
It's all right. You needn't explain.
Sometimes it's necessary to...
It's all right. You needn't explain, Artie. We're going to throw this away now.
There's a half case under the sink.
And we'll get rid of that, too. We'll have no more of it in this house.
I'll do it. Diane? I'm in too far to quit.
I really didn't expect you to.
Consumers League declares new evidence shows company lied.
Dr. Joseph Neff, a Newark dentist who treated Amalia, has turned over portions of the jawbone he removed from her mouth. This x-ray film shows that the jawbone is still radioactive 5 years after the girl died.
Will this make your case?
Will this force a settlement?
Make our case? No. This gentleman will make our case.
Last night in a graphic exclusive. The founder of the Radium Corporation broke his long silence with this shocking announcement.
Radium is one of the most dangerous substances known to man.
Dr. von Sashaki, is it true that you assisted with the autopsy?
Yeah. And given my expertise in radium extraction, I was able to determine that Miss Maggio absorbed enough radium to kill 10 people.
Doctor, what does this mean for mild radium therapy? Are you now advising against it?
Radium is responsible for the deaths of these poor girls. It should be considered a most dangerous substance.
You agree with the doctor's prognosis that the radium girls only have a year to live?
From what I've seen, they'll be lucky to last that long.
I'll tell you what we should have done. We should have taken that reporter up on her offer when we had the chance. That's what we should have done.
$5,000. Don't make me laugh.
We should have talked her up, too, because I'll tell you what, they'd have paid. And I'll tell you what else we should have done.
Stop telling me what we should have done. Lots of things we should have done. It don't do no good to think about them now.
All right, keep your shirt on.
What do you think, the red or the blue?
So what's Barry say? Is he gonna go back to the company?
I like the red, but it don't fit so good these days.
Is he gonna try to talk the company up a bit?
Miss Wiley thinks another interview will do the job, so I say what's one more, you know?
It's worth a try, don't you think? What if they came up to 5,000? Would you take it then?
Let them come up. I'm not caving in.
It's called a settlement.
A settlement? It's just a way for them to hide.
Let them hide.
Then they win.
So they win. They're gonna win anyway.
Nice, you got so much confidence in me.
Grace, for Christ's sake, you got one lawyer working for nothing up against six other lawyers that are getting a bundle. And you think you got a chance?
You know what I found out today? They put lead screens in the laboratory for the technicians. Did they give us lead screens?
Oh, Jesus.
What do you think, 100 girls in a room and they're gonna spend that kind of money on us?
Grace.
And they want to keep it all quiet.
And
Miss Wiley
here,
says
Grace?
They're gonna close down here and move
Grace.
Across the river to New York
Grace.
To open up another factory like nothing ever
What are
happened.
We doing here, Grace? I thought the idea was you'd get some money to settle your debts, we'd get a better doctor, and we could get on with things.
Get on with things?
You're still wearing my ring.
Oh, Tommy.
Grace, there's a house for sale in my brother's neighborhood. Two rooms up, two rooms down. It's not much, but it's a start. You'll like it. It's already got flowered wallpaper. And best of all, it's only 3 blocks from the school.
The school? What do we need with a school?
Plan ahead for once.
Tommy. What do you think is gonna happen after all of this is over? Do you think everything will just go back to the way it was?
Why wouldn't it?
I gotta see the surgeon again.
Uh-huh.
I got some fluid. He's gonna drain it.
Okay.
And then he says there'll be more.
So we deal with it when it comes.
And then more and still more and then more and still more. Why can't you see that? How can you talk about buying houses and getting married when you know there's nothing?
Grace, I can't think about that. All I want is for us to be together now. To come home to you at night. To my wife. My home. I'm too old to be living this in-between life. I promise I'll do whatever it takes to make it easy for you.
Here.
Grace, come on.
I should have given it back to you a long time ago.
I don't want it.
Tommy, please. Are you gonna make me say it?
You just need to get some rest. You're not getting enough sleep.
Tommy!
I'll be back to see you tomorrow.
Tommy!
You get some sleep.
Tommy, don't you do this to me! Tommy!
Charlie! Aren't you headed home?
Charlie, I've been thinking it over. I think we're taking the wrong approach here. I think we need to settle the case. We gotta make a reasonable offer to those girls.
No, Arthur, we agreed. We need a definitive victory, otherwise we invite more of this nonsense.
Things have changed.
Arthur, I know you and Dan were close, but you can't let that cloud your judgment.
Von Sashaki's gonna testify.
We can deal with him.
How?
Put more money in his pocket.
Now you wanna bribe him?
Not a bribe. Consideration.
Consideration?
For an expert witness. Whatever Barry is paying him, we'll just pay him more.
You don't understand, Gil. Do you, Charlie?
Right now, I don't have the luxury of thinking about it.
Well, let me tell you something, Charlie. A guilty man has a tremendous need to unburden himself. His guilt can eat him alive. Don't you see? What Von Sashaki wants is to be free. That's why he's testifying for those girls, and that's why he'll never testify for us.
Settle with these girls, and you'll have to settle with all the rest. Neff was right about that. This is only the beginning.
Tell Markley to get in touch with Barry. Get a conversation going. Come up with a figure the girls can accept.
For God's sake, Arthur, what are you trying to do to me? Do you want to wipe me out?
We gotta get this off the table.
Every penny I have put by in the last 7 years, I have sunk into this company. Why? Because of you. You said it was a sure thing, no miss. Why work for Von Sashaki when we can work for ourselves? Remember that one, Arthur? Take a chance, Charlie. Take a chance.
Charlie, we were fooled. Von Sashaki fooled us all. The only thing we can do now is try to clean it up as best as we can.
Do this, and it's the end, Arthur.
You're stepping down, Charlie?
Not me.
Well?
Don't you know? Ah. They're one vote away from getting rid of you.
And whose vote is that, Charlie?
Arthur, have you so little faith in me?
I'm still a shareholder, Charlie. They won't have enough votes to get me off the board. I'll still be on the board.
And still on the hook if the company goes under. Think about that the next time your conscience starts to bother you.
March 15th, 1928. To Mr. Raymond Barry, attorney at law. From Edward Markley, counsel, U.S. Radium. One of our expert witnesses has encountered a scheduling conflict and cannot testify in April. We have therefore requested an extension until June, as per your request for a settlement. Every case contains some humanitarian aspect. Therefore, I am afraid that cannot be the basis for settling this one. However, I've no doubt you will be rewarded for the good work you are doing. If not in this world, then in the next.
Grace?
Mama?
Grace?
Huh?
Mr. Markley will be here any minute.
Mr. Markley?
He's bringing the papers for you to sign. Did you fall asleep?
Has Miss Wiley been by?
Miss Wiley?
About Catherine. She told me she might come by. Did she stop by?
She might have.
Don't you know?
Look, someone came to the door a while ago. I think your brother answered it. Look, Grace, you gotta get ready.
They took Catherine back to the hospital last night.
I know, dear. After you talk to Mr. Markley, we'll go over there and see how she is now. Put a comb through your hair.
I dreamt she'd die.
Grace! Don't speak such things.
If she dies, it's over.
We're 3 months behind on the mortgage, Grace.
I know that.
You can't let this go on.
$1,500. Not even a year's wages.
Well, it's better than nothing, ain't it?
Is that all I'm worth? Better than nothing?
Well, of course not, sweetheart, but you gotta be realistic. At the rate things are going, you'll never get inside a courtroom, and, well, even if you do, you can't prove nothing.
Mr. Barry thinks we can.
Mr. Barry ain't paying the bills. There's the doctor and the bank and the Coleman, and we can't expect folks to treat us like charity just because you're sick.
I'm not asking for charity, Ma. I just want what's owed to me.
Grace, I know it feels like you're letting Catherine down, but if she decided to take the company's offer, would you hold it against her? No, you wouldn't. Now, we'll take that check and pay the bills, and whatever's left, you and Tommy can have a little something to get you started.
There's nothing to start, Ma.
Why do you have to be so hard on Tommy? Can't you see he just can't face the thought of you not being with us?
Please don't. I have to face it. Why can't he?
Do something with your hair, Grace.
$250,000. What would you do with $250,000, Miss Fryer? Why, I can't imagine. No point to it. Ma! Why didn't you tell me I got mail?
New Mexico.
Huh? They just keep writing. She was here.
Miss Wiley was here. Ma, Miss
Wiley was here this morning. She left me a note.
Ah, Miss Fryer. Edward Markling.
Ma said you brought papers.
Yes, the terms as we explained in our letter. $1,500 to you. I've got the check right here. All we need is your signature. It's in triplicate.
Grace, Mr. Markley is a very busy man.
Oh, no, please. Look them over carefully. If you prefer, I can leave the papers here and pick them up tomorrow.
No, no. We'll do this now.
What? Hold harmless?
You agree to hold the company harmless for any further action.
No more losses.
Correct.
This is a confidential settlement.
Yes?
You didn't say nothing about it being confidential.
It's standard for most legal proceedings, Miss Fryer. We like to protect our privacy. And yours as well. It cuts both ways.
That seems fair.
Need a pen?
I have another question.
Grace, Mr. Markley already explained the term.
I don't mind.
What's contributory negligence? It's not in that one. It's in them other papers that you filed when we did the lawsuit. The radium company said its defense was the statute of limitations and contributory negligence.
I'm not quite sure what you're asking, Miss Fryer.
It means it's our fault, don't it?
Oh, no, it's a standard defense. I wouldn't take it personally.
How else can I take it?
Mr. Markley, Grace has had an awful headache all day. Maybe you could leave the...
Maybe he can just answer the question.
Why are you doing this?
Why didn't you tell me Miss Wiley came by?
You already made up your mind. She'd only try to talk you out of it.
What did she say about Catherine?
Mr. Markley, Grace was...
Ma! What did she say about Catherine?
She said it don't look good.
Perhaps I should come back tomorrow when Miss Fryer's feeling a little better.
You didn't answer my question, Mr. Markley. And I'd really like an answer. Because let me tell you, I quit school at 15. I went to work at your radium plant because my folks needed the money. At your factory, they told us what to do, when to do it, how to do it. My folks didn't raise me to make trouble, so I didn't make trouble. I did what I was told. I never asked questions. How do you get contributory negligence out of that?
As I said, it's a standard defense.
There's nothing standard about what happened to me.
We deeply regret your situation, but there is no evidence tying your condition to any actions by the U.S. Radium Corporation.
Then why are you giving me this money?
It's a humanitarian gesture.
A humanitarian gesture?
I'll take them papers.
Humanitarian? Month after month, you put us off. Delay after delay. Knowing how sick we were, how tired and desperate. Humanitarian? You're just waiting for us to die!
Right, please stop this now!
This is a very generous offer, and I would advise you take it, because it won't be on the table for very long.
What do you mean?
If Miss Fryer does not sign within the next 24 hours, we will be forced to withdraw our offer permanently.
Grace.
He's lying.
I beg your pardon, miss.
You're trying to tell me if I don't sign these now? But I came back a week from now and said I changed my mind? You'd still rather go to court
You'd still rather some judge take a look at me and take your chances I will win on sympathy alone.
24 hours. You're just trying to bully me.
Very well then, Miss Fryer. I'll take that as a no. And we'll see you in court!
Yes, you will! You will see me! If they have to carry me in there, you'll see me! You and Mr. Reed are both!
You call that man back!
I'm going to court, Ma.
What are you trying to prove? You know you can't win!
I want those people to look at me. I want them to look at me and explain how it's my fault I got sick working in their factory.
And what will that get you? What?
Ma. All my life, I've done what other people told me to do. I quit school because you said I should. I put that brush in my mouth because Mrs. McNeil said I should. I never said, please, can't I finish school? I never said, I don't like the taste of this paint. Even though I knew, Ma, I knew something wasn't right. At night, I'd lie in bed and I'd see my dress hanging on the back of the closet door, all aglow. My shoes on the floor, my hairbrush and comb on the dresser. So much light, Ma. So much light. And I never once questioned. I never once asked. Don't you see? They knew I wouldn't. That's what they were counting on.
Arthur, so, it is you making all this noise.
I left messages with your housekeeper. I know you got the messages.
Seeing as we are no longer in business together, I thought it best not to respond.
Is that what this is about?
Perhaps a cup of tea will calm your nerves.
You never said the paint was dangerous. You never said a word about it, not to me. Not to Dan.
I didn't know.
You didn't know. You invented the paint and you didn't know.
I didn't know until it was too late, Arthur.
I should put you through that wall.
Perhaps you should. But you will not. You will sit down, you will have some tea, and you will calm yourself.
I wasn't the technical man. You were the technical man.
Yeah, I was the technical man. Sit down, Arthur.
I sold watches, for Christ's sakes. I was a salesman.
A very good one at that. Always a very good head for the business you have. For the science, not so much. But for the business, very smart. Always you could find ways to cut costs without losing the quality. That's a gift, Arthur. So, why don't you have some tea?
Jesus Christ, what's the matter with your hands?
They've been that way for some time.
What, have you been dipping them in ink?
Dipping them in ink? How fond of the pretty story you are, Arthur. No, if only it were ink. Dr. Martin tells me it's a necrosis of the tissue. The cells. Sir, thank. This is the dial painters in the jaw. It started the necrosis. This me in the hands.
I had no idea.
I see no reason why you should. I have not seen you in some time.
How long do you
but
have?
But I've known for a while. Miss Wiley from the Consumers League persuaded me to assist Dr. Martland in testing the girls for radium exposure. There aren't that many people, you know, who can measure that sort of thing. So she came to me, knowing I had the equipment and, of course, the skill. I didn't want to believe her either, Arthur. I didn't want to believe that the girls could get sick from working with my paint. I wanted to show her it was all a mistake. So I agreed to help. Dr. Martland and I conducted expired air tests on the girls. It was then that I found out, when my own breath registered as radioactive. And then the fingers, say, began to turn black. Now, you wish to have words with me.
I'm so sorry.
Well, perhaps now you yourself should make an appointment with Dr. Marfland.
Me? What for?
Arthur, you did not notice the glowing dust on your shoes when you came home at night.
How could I miss it? I tracked it all over the house.
You can be quite certain that a good deal of it is now in your lungs. Look familiar?
It's our promotional piece.
An excellent promotion. How many new sales did that book account for?
I didn't track it quite exactly. I like to think it helped our medical market quite
a bit. Page 96.
What?
The last chapter. Read it to me.
The last chapter. Radium. Dangerous effects.
Dangerous effects. How many articles do you have listed there? 10? 15?
About 18, it looks like.
And how far back do say go, those articles?
I don't know.
The first one, there, read it to me.
1906.
Now let me get this straight. When you go into court, you plan to testify that you had no idea Sir Radium was dangerous. How can you do that, Arthur, when your own book says that it was?
I never really read it.
What's that?
I never really read it. I hired a man to put it together. I just glanced at the galleys. I never really read the book.
How do you mean you never read the book?
It was a standard arrangement. An outside company prepared the piece, and they were responsible for the content.
Which you never read.
I think you'll find, Mr. Barry, that very few company presidents read their own promotions word for word.
It has your name on it. You had final authorization over the book's release, and final say over the content.
Mr. Lee was responsible for our promotional efforts at the time. I entrusted those activities to him.
Now, Mr. Reader, you testified that you started working at the U.S. Radium Corporation in 1918?
Yes, as plant manager.
And you held this position for how long?
4 years.
During those 4 years, how often did you venture into the studio?
Every day.
Every day. So you must have seen the girls pointing the brushes to their mouths.
I don't recall.
You're saying you went into the studio every day and never saw a single girl point a brush to her lips?
I said I don't recall it.
You don't recall it? What do you recall, Mr. Reader? You're an awfully young man to have such a faulty memory.
Objection!
I withdraw. No more questions.
Mr. Markley, your witness.
We have no questions for this witness, Your Honor.
All right, gentlemen. Please approach. I'm ready to issue my ruling.
Your Honor, we have yet to present our defense.
I realize that, Mr. Markley, but this proceeding is to determine standing. Now, I've heard enough these past 2 days to make that determination. The radium in the bones of these girls is an ongoing source of poison in their systems. Frankly, nothing your witnesses can say will change that fact, will it?
Our witnesses are prepared to testify that the company could not have known
Mr. Markley, in the interest of justice, I'm asking that the defense rest without calling any witnesses. We can conclude this hearing today and schedule the case for trial.
All right, Your Honor.
Fine. I therefore rule that the statute of limitations has not been exhausted, and these girls have standing to sue.
Your Honor, one thing. I have a very busy schedule with two other cases pending, and a key witness will not be available until the end of the summer. We can't be available until September.
Your Honor,
he is involved with an institution of higher learning, and this is the busiest time of year for him, and I cannot expect him to appear.
Mr. Markley is the one responsible for that situation. He is the one who has demanded continuous delays.
Your Honor, we have just waived our right to present witnesses at this hearing. Surely you will not make us make our defense without the presence of a key witness.
All right, Mr. Markley. Trial is set for September, and this hearing is adjourned.
Edward? Why can't Flynn appear?
He's going to Europe.
Flynn's going to Europe? But he's known about this for months. Why in the world would he ever... Oh, I see. Very clever, Edward. How long do you plan to keep this up?
As long as necessary.
Mr. Markley?
Ah, Mr. Barry, congratulations. I never thought the court would go for
You know full well the girls can't wait until September. One is so ill she can't appear in the courtroom.
My client has a right to make his defense.
We will not wait until September. I promise you that. One way or another, we will find room on the docket. And let your expert witness be damned.
Edward, that girl is still staring at me.
I wouldn't worry about it.
She thinks it's personal. That I planned this somehow. How do I make her understand I didn't want this to happen to her?
Don't make her understand. You don't look at her, you don't talk to her.
But she looks like death, Edward.
They all look like death, Arthur.
Grace?
That man, Miss Wiley. He won't look at me. He won't ever look at me. He just looks right past me, like I'm not even here.
It doesn't matter, Grace. He heard you.
June 4th, 1928, Nancy Jane Harlan for the New York Graphic.
Jack Youngwood reporting for the New York Ledger, New York's first source for news.
Raymond Barry seeks trial date for early summer.
As U.S. Radium Corporation announces a settlement.
A settlement?
$10,000 cash for each girl and $12 a week for life.
$12 a week?
Read all about it in the Ledger.
The company agrees to pay the medical expenses of each girl for the remainder of her life. And the girls have agreed to a periodic examination by a panel of physicians yet to be appointed. Questions?
What led to the settlement?
Is this an admission of responsibility?
What about the other pending cases?
It was purely for humanitarian reasons that the company agreed to the settlement. We admit no liability whatsoever.
Where does the company go from here?
The company is pleased to have brought this lengthy litigation to a close and looks forward to many more years serving its customers and this community. And that's C.B. Lee. President.
Catherine Wiley of the New Jersey Consumers League, our press statement.
Were you pleased with the outcome, Miss Wiley?
Finally, these poor girls received some compensation for their suffering. But more importantly, the issue of radium poisoning has been brought to public awareness.
Thank you, Miss Wiley.
The spelling, by the way, is Wiley with one L and Catherine with a K.
Well, Edward, looks like we're back in business.
What's your game plan?
Didn't I tell you? I've got a buyer for the tailings that have been piling up behind the building on Alden Street.
Oh?
Some contractor in Montclair needs a little infill.
That's perfect!
Now, Catherine. This won't do. We can't see your name. That's better. Well, Catherine, it's a beautiful day. The trees are starting to turn, but it's still warm. Too warm for a sweater. Not much of a breeze. A fine day to paint.
Thought I might find you up here.
You were right.
It's quiet up here.
Yep.
Well, I guess if you can rest in peace, this is the place to do it, huh?
I guess it is.
What do you call that?
Watercolors. I'm a little weak when it comes to landscapes, though.
No, it's good, Grace. It's nice.
The first thing I bought with my settlement money was some paints. Got some oils, too.
Big spender.
Then I bought a car.
I didn't know you could drive.
I can't. My brother's gonna teach me. He drove me up here today.
Grace, you wanna learn how to drive? I'd teach you.
You got other things to do now, Tommy.
You know about that.
Tommy, Orange just isn't that big.
I meant to tell you myself, Grace. That's why I came looking
for you. It's okay. I'm happy for you. For both of you.
So no hard feelings then?
Oh, Tommy, you think I got time for that?
I'm glad it worked out for you, Grace. Are you glad? You don't think you backed down too soon, do ya?
We didn't back down. They backed down.
Papa?
It was over here.
Papa, not this again.
This is where I saw her that last time.
Papa, this is morbid.
I stood there for a long time. She didn't notice me at first, but then something made her look up.
Oh my.
No wonder Mama won't mow drives you anymore. If this is how you spend your Sundays.
I saw her looking at me, and I looked away.
Just like at the courthouse that day. He can't bring himself to look at me.
We need to find you a new hobby. Retirement is not good for you, Papa.
My heart started pounding, Harriet. I never knew what I was going to say to her if I had the chance. And suddenly, there she was. And I had the chance.
So what did you say?
I couldn't bring myself to speak.
It's as if he's afraid to look at me.
I had my chance, and I couldn't speak.
He's afraid of me.
Papa, that was years ago, and it's not like it was your fault. Nobody knew about things like that back then. Science just wasn't as advanced as it is now.
I think back in those days, and I try to wonder, how could it have happened? I remember so clearly climbing the stairs to the studio at Alden Street. At the top of the stairs, those wide, high windows and the slant of light, the way it hit the floor, the way the floor creaked under my feet, and the smell of the place, chalky like an old schoolroom. And all those girls, schoolgirls really, all bent to the task in their plain green smocks, their delicate little hands moving around so quickly. No man could work the way those girls did. So careful, so fast. Those brushes moving from the dials to the paint, back to the dials to their lips. Try as I might, Harriet. Try as I might. I cannot remember their faces. I never saw their faces.
Thank you.
we three, we're all alone, living in a memory. My echo, my shadow, and me. We three, we're not a crowd, we're not even company. My echo, my shadow, and me. What good is the moonlight, the silvery moonlight that shines above? I walk with my shadow, I talk with my echo, but where is the one I love? We three will wait for you, even till eternity. My echo, my shadow, and me.
We three, we're all alone. Seem like we're living in a memory. That's my echo, my shadow, and me. We three, we ain't no crowd. Fact is, we ain't even company. That's my echo, my shadow, and me.